Marty Haggard and I, we have been friends for, I don't know, a dozen years or so in that neighborhood. I actually met him just a little while after you started doing some ministry, I believe it was. And we have become extremely close, extremely close. We have the same Heavenly Father, and as he mentioned, I think it was last night, we are brothers from a different mother. I believe that's what it is, something like that. But he has a fantastic name. He is the son of Merle Haggard, but more than that, he is the son of our Heavenly Father. He's just going to come and do some songs, and I told him that at LifeBridge, we're not so religious that we can't do some of Merle's great songs. Some of them are fantastic, fantastic. He mentioned to me, I said, I don't want you doing all that honky-tonk music. And he said, well, my daddy didn't really do a whole lot of honky-tonk music. He said, what about the bottle let me down? I said, that's a good one, because the bottle let you down. That'll be a good one right there, for sure. All right, Marty Haggard!
Am I on now? There I am. Can you hear me now? How y'all doing? Well, I am rusty as an old gate at this. I sing in a lot during the this starting this time of year about a week from now, and goes till the end of April. And it takes me a while to get back into the frame of mind of remembering songs and talking and just doing this stuff. But I've been off really for a couple, 3 or 4 months, so I'm a little rusty. And I haven't done any ministry stuff in a couple, 3 or 4 years. So although I wrote most of these songs, I may forget some of them. I'm having trouble remembering my name these days. But anyway, Charlie and I have been friends for at least 12 years, almost as long as I've known my wife. And the guitar is not on there. Here we go. But anyway, thank you all for letting me come. I'm not going to keep you all night long. I know some of you got to get up and go to work tomorrow. And let's see. As Charlie said, I am the son of Merle Haggard. I know unless you've been hid in a cave for the last 50 years, you know who he is. But my dad is not the reason I do these things. He's not going to save nobody. Okay. In fact, he's in the need of salvation just like anybody else. And everybody always asks me, well, is your dad saved? Well, the best I can tell, yes. Okay. I can't see his heart, but I do know that he believes Jesus. And I have very little doubt that he does know Jesus, and more importantly, Jesus knows him. But I guess the same question could be asked of you. Do you know Jesus? Because I know one thing. You better make a decision on this side of the dirt, okay? Because on the other side of the dirt, it's too late. But that's, I can tell you about him, and I will, and I'll sing about it. But ultimately, it's the Holy Spirit's job to convict you. And I do know how the Father in heaven works. And if you're here, I promise you, it's not by accident. Maybe you already know him as Savior, but he would sure like you to know him more as Father. And I'm not really hearing myself like I did earlier. Is there a reason for that? What? Now, this was the same mic earlier today. It's all right. I mean, less I hear me, probably the better. I'm going to sing. I heard me there. You can turn that down a little bit. Thank you, honey. Be careful what you ask for, all right? Here's a little song I wrote. It's a lesson too late for the learning. Made of sand, made of sand. In the wink of an eye, my soul was turning in his hand. in his hand. How you going away with no words of farewell? Will there be not a trace left behind? I should have loved you better. I didn't mean to be unkind. Don't you know that was the last thing on my mind? You got your reasons, plenty for your leaving. This I know, this I know. Yeah, the weeds have been steadily growing. Please don't go. Please don't go. How you going away with no words of farewell? Will there be not a trace left behind? I should have loved you better. Didn't mean to be unkind. Don't you know that was the last thing on my mind? Don't you know that was the last thing on my mind? Thank you, folks. Okay. Charlie told me when I called, he said he wanted me to do a combination of regular secular songs of my dad's and Jesus songs. Now, that's a hard thing to go back and forth to, okay? Go up and down, up and down. I'll tell you what I'll do, Charlie. I'll do a couple of my dad's songs, okay? Because it's really hard for me to get my mind off of Jesus when I got it on Jesus, okay? And again, if you want to hear a lot of my dad's music, come see me in Arizona, okay? I'm in Arizona in a theater there. And I love my dad, and good grief, he's as good a country music singer as there's ever been and will ever be again. But, I mean, like I said, I spend a lot of time talking about him, but anybody that knows me very well at all knows that my passion is with my father. Once you've had the best, it's hard to worry about the rest, all right? But anyway, so please let me just worry about old Jesus, and I might do the one song that Charlie is wanting me to do for you, which is a really good song my dad wrote about his time in prison when he was in San Quentin prison doing time back as a kid, and a man in prison changed his life, and I'll sing that song for you, tell a little story, and really all that song and that story is about is the power of freedom. You know, America is a place of the land of the free, and you know, all, my dad's story is it can only take place in America. You know, only 10 years after being released from San Quentin prison, my dad was invited to the White House. You know, it's only in America you can go from the jailhouse to the White House in less than 10 years, all right? Seems like these days maybe we need to flip that thing. Maybe some people need to go from the White House to the jailhouse. I don't know. I don't know. I ain't pointing at no one person. Maybe it's a whole bunch of them, huh? But anyway, freedom is a powerful thing, and it is not about shackles and chains, and it's about a new start, and you can do some wonderful things, and that is the truth of the gospel. But I'm going to sing for you some songs that I wrote, mostly. Thank you. when I wake up in the morning, the first thing that I do is hit my knees. I have a little talk with my father one more time. I surrender all of me. Father, please forgive me all the first words that I say, for all the sins of this man that drove the nails into my Savior's hands that day. I say a little prayer for all the children who are lost and all alone, for the down and broken hearted, Lord, please lead those children home. Then I thank Him for the blessings, right down to the very breath I breathe, and for the son that He gave, 'cause the life that He saved belongs to me. That's how my day begins. That's how my day will end. Talking to my Father, my God, my friend. When I stumble and fall, it's to my God I call all through the day, and He hears what I say, 'cause I stay one prayer away. That's how my day begins. That's how my day will end. Talking to my Father, my God, my friend. When I stumble and fall, it's to my God I call all through the day, and He hears what I say, 'cause I stay one prayer away. When I wake up in the morning, first thing that I do is hit my knees. I have a little talk with my Father one more time. I surrender all of me. Thank y'all. Thanks, folks. Well, let's see. Boy, I'm rusty. I'm going to do you a song that I wrote about my neighbors. I'll do this for you, Mr. Malone. I live in, my wife and I, we live in Doyleane, Louisiana. It's about 20 miles east of Shreveport. And that's where my wife was born and raised. And I met her in a church up in Arkansas. I was living in Conway. And there's only two things get you in Louisiana. That's either if God's mad at you and or you marry a woman from there. Nah, I like Louisiana. It's actually a pretty good place. It really is. I was just kidding, totally. Some of the finest people I've ever met in my life are living in that little town. There's only 841 of us in Doyleane. And, but my wife and I, we live next door to the Doyleane Cemetery. And we live right across the street from Methodist Church, I say, and right next door to the Baptist Church. A bunch of dead folks. Just kidding. I'm just kidding. I've been in ministry. I've been in them all. Some of us need to wake up, okay? But anyway, I was sitting there one day looking out my kitchen window, staring at all the neighbors. And I wrote this song about it. See, let me remember. From the cradle to the grave. No, I'm just kidding. Hang on, I gotta go up here. From the cradle to the grave, it's a long, hard road. The only thing that comes easy is getting old. And I'm getting old. It's just the way it goes. The wrinkles on my face and the gray in my hair say I'm a long way from the cradle. As far as the grave goes, I'm getting there. Yes, I'm getting there. But I wouldn't turn back the hands of time if I could. The only good thing about those good old days are gone for good. When this life is over, true life begins with a happy ending that forget will never end. Yeah, when my dying is done, I will be home. Never again will I ever feel alone. When this flesh and bone has set me free, in my Savior's arms is where I'll be. Oh, what a joy it is to know there's only six more feet left to go. Well, life at its best has been an uphill climb. What makes it worth the living's at the end of the line. At the end of the line, yeah, heaven's mine. This old world ain't heaven, boy, that's for sure. But even in this valley, it's higher than I've ever been before. I've ever been before. Cause through the eyes of faith, I can almost see a mansion on a hill he has built for me. I never dreamed I would ever say I could ever live to love my dying day. But when my dying is done, I will be home. Never again will I ever feel alone. When this flesh and bone has set me free, in my Savior's arms is where I'll be. Oh, what a joy it is to know there's only six more feet left to go. When this flesh and bone has set me free, in my Savior's arms is where I'll be. At the end of this long, hard road, there's only six more feet left to go. There's only six more feet left to go. Thank you, folks. Oh, thank you. Thank y'all. What do y'all want to hear? The bridge. Don't. Yeah, and remember, we're not supposed to act like a bunch of Baptists tonight, okay? Except you. I'm just kidding. Oh, I took a nap, and I probably shouldn't have done that. Is that pure water? Sherry? Let me make sure. I don't want to get shocked. Yeah, it's just water. Huh? I do. You take my breath away, Linda. Very first song that I ever wrote. Let me tell you quickly how this came about. I've been saved for a long time. In fact, I really don't remember the exact moment because I don't remember not knowing Jesus personally all the way back to childhood. But I will say this, that in my early 20s, I went to Nashville to get into the music business and sure didn't go there with no intentions of ever sliding away and losing focus, but I did. I went to Nashville. I wanted to play music for a living, and went there and started pursuing a music deal and a record deal and all that kind of stuff. And I did pretty well with it. I got a couple record deals, and actually was nominated in 1987 as one of the top new male vocalists of the year in country music. was doing really well, but the problem was I had really gotten out of focus with Jesus and lost my way a little bit. And it was around 1997. I was sitting there one day in Nashville thinking about nothing. I was just daydreaming. And my mind went back to the minute that I remember, the best I could remember, meeting Jesus. And I started thinking about that. And I started writing this song. And it was the first time that I really put much thought to Jesus in quite a while. And I started writing this song about, I guess, about a third of the way into the song, I realized how far from him I had really drifted and didn't realize it. And as Charlie may have already said to you at one time or another, it was at that moment that I made my mind up to leave Nashville and go somewhere where I didn't know anybody and start over, because I had gotten way too far away from Jesus and I didn't like it. And this song reminded me how peaceful and wonderful it was when I was with him, walking with him. So I made the decision at that point to go back to Jesus. But in order to do that, I left Nashville. And I ended up in Conway, Arkansas. Has anybody here ever been to Conway, Arkansas? Uh-huh. I didn't know anybody there, and I just walked in off the streets. I took a Greyhound bus out of Nashville, Tennessee. I wasn't married at the time. I didn't have nothing tying me down, but I gave everything I thought was worth more than Jesus and gave it away. And I got on an old Greyhound bus headed west. I didn't know where I was headed, but I ended up in Conway. I was 40 years old. That was 15 years ago. And I got off that bus. I had about $150 in my pocket and nothing but a Bible and a handful of clothes. And started over. Found me a little church there in town called Metalik Baptist Church. And started back over. And didn't have no money, so I was walking everywhere I went. I got me a job washing dishes and bussing tables at the Cracker Barrel restaurant, making just enough money to pay for the hotel that I was in and buy me some ramen noodles here and there. And but I don't know, a couple, 3 weeks into this walk, I realized that this was where I needed to be. And I remember this song that I had started in Nashville and realized that I hadn't finished it. So I finished it there in Conway. I started in Nashville with this song and finished it in Conway. The first half was out of fellowship. The last half was in fellowship. And I will never stray again. And I can say that with confidence. I know a lot more than I knew back then. But this is a song I do for my friend down front and my friend back there. First song I ever wrote for Jesus. I remember the day to you my heart I gave, how you took my breath away. The peace and love inside, the tears of joy I cried. Lord, you took my breath away. And when I think of how you gave your life so mine was saved, Lord, that takes my breath away. How you still love the man that drove the nails into your hands. That kind of love just takes my breath away. Lord, take my eyes if they can't see what your love means to me. If someday from you they stray, Lord, please take my sight away. Take these words that I speak, if they're not the truth and love you teach, make these the last words that I say. Lord, please take my voice away. Take my legs, before I stray or walk away from you again. I'd rather cross, take this life that I live, is like you gave for me, my Lord. I'd give it all before I fall. Lord, take my breath away. Lord, take it all. Take my breath away. Thank you all. I was shackled by a heavy burden beneath a load of guilt and shame. Then the hand of Jesus touched me, and now I am no longer the same. Yes, he touched me. Oh, he touched me. Oh, the joy that floods my soul. Oh, something, yes, it happened, and now how I know. Oh, he touched me, and he made me whole. Yes, since I met this blessed Savior, yes, since he cleansed and made me whole, I will never cease to praise him, and I'll shout it while eternity rolls. 'Cause he touched me. Oh, he touched me. Oh, the joy that floods my soul. Oh, something, yes, it happened, and now how I know. Oh, he touched me, and he made me whole. Yes, something, yes, it happened, and now how I know. Touched me, and he made me whole. Oh, yes, he touched me, and he made me whole. Ouch! Thank you, folks. My hands are hurting. I'm not used to playing guitar. By gosh, I'm rusty. Hey, most of you people are smiling back at me, but a couple of you cannot get away from the Bulldogs dipped in lemon juice, Charlie. Oh, well, let's see. Well, that's what a lot of folks look like. Well, of course, if I was looking at me, I'd look like that too, though, so. Huh? Finger hurts. All that guitar playing last night killed me. Well, I'm kind of homesick. for a country. Which I've never been before. No sad goodbye will ever be spoken. And time won't matter anymore. In Beulah land, I am longing for you. And someday on thee I'll stand, where my home shall be eternal. Beulah land, my sweet Beulah land, I'm looking now across that river, where my faith is gonna end inside. There's just a few more days to labor, then we'll take that heavenly flight to Beulah land. I'm longing for you, and someday on thee I'll stand, where my home shall be eternal. Beulah land, my sweet Beulah land, well, I'm talking about her home. We'll see Jesus face to face, and I'm talking about peace and love, well, in sweet Beulah land. Thank you, folks. Thank you all very much. Charlie asked me to do you a song that I wrote. Let me see if I can remember it. It's a song called Easy for Who. I was talking to a friend one day in Arkansas about Jesus. And we were discussing salvation. You know, a lot of people have a hard time believing that believing alone can save you, okay? And it is natural. Well, let me rephrase that. It's unnatural. Because anything we think is not natural, it's unnatural. Trust me. You know, the sinful flesh, we think right, but we think wrong. We think too much. I know what the Bible says, and it makes perfect sense to me now. If you cannot work your way into heaven, if you can't work your way in, how in the world can you work your way out? If your work ain't got nothing to do with getting in, how can your work have anything to do with getting out? It don't make any sense, y'all. It's one or the other. It's all on you or it's all on him. You can take it however you choose, but I think I'll throw myself at the mercy of Jesus, okay? A lot of people say, well, this kind of talk just promotes doing whatever you want to do. You're just giving people a license to sin by talking like that. I ain't giving no license to nobody, first of all. They don't need no license. They're sinning pretty good without one, okay? But, you know, anyway, we could be here all day long talking about it, but I ain't going to get into it no more except to say that faith alone is what saves you, if it's in Jesus. You know, everybody faiths something. You can either faith in yourself, but I don't, the Bible says, he said, many will come before me, and I, And I will say, depart from me, worker of iniquity, I never knew you. He didn't say faither of iniquity. He said worker. I ain't no worker. I'm a faither. And if I'm wrong about what I'm claiming, I've misread the scripture, first of all. Second of all, that means at some point, Jesus is going to say, depart from me. You've had too much faith in me. I don't believe I'll ever hear those words out of his lips. But I was talking to my friend about salvation, and he kept saying it was just too easy, believing in Jesus alone. And I kept trying to tell him, well, if it's so doggone easy, why can't you do it? What's the big deal, buddy? It's not easy standing still and believing in Jesus. Quit trying to add to it with some work. So just in case the faith don't work, I think I'll go ahead and work over here. You might want to be careful with that mindset, because I'm not too sure what you have is faith. Okay, I don't know. I'm hoping that... I do know the Bible says as long as you believe that Jesus is the Son of God, raised from the dead by God, the Savior of the world, that you will be saved. And I'm believing, I'm hoping a man can go right there and even take one step past it and get crazy in his thinking, and hopefully they're still saved. I hope. But I don't know. I don't know if I want to mess around with salvation. But I was talking to my friend about it, and we discussed it for a long time. And anyway, after he left, I wrote this song. It's called Easy for Who. That's what he kept telling me. It's easy. You ever heard this, Sydney? I was talking to a friend the other day about this salvation plan that God hath made. The simplicity, how easily a man can be saved. Well, it's so easy, it's hard, I said, to understand. You're not saved by the works of your own hands. It's by the grace of God, through faith and trust in the Son that He gave. But He said there must be something a man's got to do. He said that's all too easy. I said, easy for who? What's so easy about the crown of thorns that Jesus wore? What's so easy about the pain and the shame of sin He bore? What's so easy about the way He died? Look at the cross from my Savior's side and tell me that's easy. Christ did it all on Calvary. There's nothing left that a man can do but believe. And He says that's easy, too easy to be true. Well, if it's so easy to believe, my friend, why can't you? When you say it's easy to be true, the only question that I have, my friend, is easy for who? Thank you, folks. My fingers hurt. Every time I hit a string, I'm seeing dead relatives. I am a poor wayfaring stranger while passing through this world of woe. There's no sickness, no torn and danger in that bright world for which I go. I'm going there to see my Father. Going there no more to roam. I'm only going over Jordan. I'm only going going over home. I know dark clouds will gather round me, and I know my way is rough and steep. Beauteous fields lie just before me, where God's redeemed their vigils keep. I'm going there to see my mother. She said she'd meet me when I come. I'm only going over Jordan. I'm only going over home. I'll soon be free from every trial, and my body sleeps in this old churchyard. And I'll drop the cross of self-denial and enter on my great reward. I'm going there to see my Savior, sing His praise forevermore. I'm only going over Jordan. I'm only going over home. I'm only going over home. Well, thank you very much. Oh, thank you, guys. Well, most of you are smiling pretty good. Doggone it. Of course, anything would be a relief from having to look at Charlie Ellison all night. Uh-huh. Even though we love each other, don't you? You can tell. Women don't get men, by the way. They think, man, you guys are mean to each other. No, you don't get it. If we ain't being mean to each other, that means we don't like each other, okay? The meaner we are with each other, the more in love we are. Don't ask me. It's a sin thing, I'm sure, okay? I'm pretty sure it's a sinful thing. But it's the truth. I do love Charlie. Charlie loves people. And that, the very minute I met Charlie, that's the thing that stood out. I still stand by what I felt about him the minute I met him as today. We've talked a million and one times about theology and the difference in some ways of thinking and stuff, but that's not debatable. Charlie loves people, and that makes perfect sense since he's the son of the Father, see. And I do want to point out something that Charlie said this morning, and make a little alteration to it, if that's okay, Charlie. Why not? I mean, when have I ever stopped? The Father, he did not say in Scripture that he so loved the world anyway. He said, I so love the world, period. Anyway, really is not a good way to look at it. There are no conditions to love. He don't see us. You know, remember the movie Unforgiven with Clint Eastwood? If you didn't, you need to go see it. It's a great movie. But there's a scene at the very end of the movie when Clint Eastwood's getting ready to shoot the sheriff, right? The sheriff was a corrupt man, a bad man. He'd already killed Will Penny was his name. Clint Eastwood's character was Penny, Will Penny. But the sheriff had brutally killed his friend, and it unleashed wrath on that sheriff and all his boys. At the very end, he took care of everybody in the room, and the sheriff was last. He was laying there on the ground, that sheriff was. He'd built the town, that sheriff had. He was benefiting off all the fear he was peddling. But he was laying on the ground. He'd already been wounded, and Clint was getting ready to dust him off, send him on to where he belonged. And he pulled up the shotgun. He was pointing down at him. And that sheriff looked up at him. He says, I don't deserve this. Clint Eastwood said, deserve ain't got nothing to do with it. Boom. It's a hard pill to swallow, but deserve ain't got nothing to do with it. Okay, it just is what it is. You know, I don't love my son at home in spite of stuff he does. I don't love my son at home because of stuff he does. His conduct has nothing to do, good or bad, with my love for him. I don't love him because of what he does or don't do, and I don't overlook what he does or don't do. I can't. All I can see is my son, and I love him, period. And if I don't start learning how to accept the love without question, it's not because of me. It's not in spite of me. It just is. That's a hard thing to explain, but we are so conditional in our thinking. And the agape love the Father has for us has no conditions in it. It's not because of, and it's not in spite of. You can't be loved anymore, no matter how good you do. And you can't be loved any less, no matter how bad you do. So why do we bring up anyway, and or in spite of? It's not the way He views us. And if we don't grow up to the point of seeing us through His eyes, we're never going to get it. And there's so much more to it. But anyway, so a friend of mine said, well, I deserve to go to hell. No, you don't. Hell was never designed for a man. It was designed for Satan. He's the one and only one that deserves to go there. And he will go there. And I know some people say that grace has no limitations. I personally challenge that. Grace was never offered to Satan. I don't know how else to look at it, except the second Adam and Eve fell, the Father said, here, cover yourself with this. And he pointed to Satan and said, you shall be cursed forever. And he's basically, your days are coming. I'm going to get you. But the ones that Satan had victimized, he immediately reached out and offered them cover for what had gone on. He offered them his grace immediately. But he never offered his grace to the guilty one. We could be here all day long, folks. We've been taught terrible things in the churches, and we view ourselves improperly. I know how the Father views me. He says in His Scripture, by the way, Paul said this, that you and I, we are His crowning glory. Now, the last time I checked, I've never seen a crown set on the feet of a king. I've only seen it set on the head of the king. When He says, you are my crown, that's above all creation. We are the precious creation of the Creator. And even in our fallen state, that's not what He sees. We've always been precious in His sight and always will be. And it's not because I'm so doggone lovable. Charlie, you're a wonderful man, but, you know. But, you know, the worst scoundrel on the earth or the nicest person to ever draw breath, that's not what He sees. He sees His perfect creation. And we will be in perfect state again one day, but I sure am glad to know that I ain't got to jump through no hoops. And my son is a great little artist, by the way. I do jump up and down and get a little giddy over some of his artwork. Because when he was a little bitty kid, about 4 or 5 years old, he'd draw me a picture. Now, he's a great artist. He's gifted, actually. But even at 4 and 5, it was still a child's art. And he would hand me that artwork. And I'd see that look in his face. Of course, I would just like, wow. And I'd hang that picture on the icebox for everybody to see. Now, was I excited about the art, or was I excited about the artist? The art itself really wasn't that big a deal. Good grief. He's just a kid. But to the daddy, that was a perfect piece of work. But because all I saw was a perfect son. And we're so caught up in the work when the Father's only caught up in the worker, us. Anyway, we could be here all day long. And it is a hard thing to accept sometimes because our own natures, the sinful natures that we have, are so busy trying to polish our little halos and trying to make us just a little bit more acceptable and lovable. But folks, deserve ain't got nothing to do with it. It just is what it is. And I'm really, 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 really thankful that he don't see my work. He sees me. But I'm sure he's got him a little ice box up there with a little bit of my work hanging on it. You know? And, you know, pointing out to old Jesus, you got to love him. Okay? You got to love him. He thinks that little song he wrote something special. And it is. Because he is. This is truth. And almost through the eye, if we could just see him through the eyes of a father and a son, we might get a little better. You know what I think I'll do? I think I'll sing you a song I wrote about this very issue. I like this song, even if I did write it. Every word of it's in Scripture. I know that for a fact. It's what he says about me because of one thing, Jesus. You know, you mentioned this morning about Abraham, and it was accounted unto him as righteousness. It's a banking term, imputed. You know, when my dad passes away, he's going to pass away. The if is he going to have anything to leave us? That's the big if. His wives probably say no. He's got one for every finger, all right? And this last one's milking him like a Jersey boy. Hey, I don't know if he's going to have anything left. That's beside the point. If he leaves me $1, it's going to be accounted to me. And it's not going to be a dollar that I've earned, but it's still going to be mine just the same. It will be imputed into my name. And I will, and that's exactly what's taking place when you step into Jesus. The law allows him. The law is the issue here. The incorruptible law that man is being held accountable to. Jesus came to do one thing. Everybody, we're all so ate up. It's all about Jesus. Now listen, be careful. Listen to what I got to say here, because this is something that gets you branded a heretic real quick. Because I try not to shock people, believe it or not. But the fact is, the truth is shocking sometimes. The fact is, the Bible repeatedly says that Jesus came to do something. Well, that something is actually the issue. He came to fulfill the law. He came to complete the law. He came to satisfy the law. The law is the issue. Okay? Because if you stand on the wrong side of Jesus, you stand on the broken side of the law. Okay, that's the law that you and I cannot keep, the Mosaic law. We can't keep it. We were broke coming out of the womb. So we are enmities to the law. The law is going, you are condemned by the law. And this is a law that can't turn a blind eye and just blanket sin. It has to deal with it. And there's only one way to deal with it, and that is through death. And that death he's talking about there is the separation for eternity from God, spiritually speaking. That's a death you don't want to experience. But here's the really good news, the gospel, if you will. Everybody says, what is the good news, Jesus? No, it's not. He's the vehicle to the good news. It's through the Son, the perfect sacrifice, the perfect payment. Wait, the payment had to be paid to who? The law. The law is the gospel. The good news is this. That law that once pursued you and I as outlaws and criminals, Jesus went before the court and offered himself for us. And the court accepted him. And as long as you accept the payment, you step over Jesus, and now you're on the completed side of the law. And if you understand the laws of adoption, you'll understand the gospel. Charlie, I would have thought that you should understand this better than anybody since you've been adopted. This is about, anybody in here ever adopted a child by chance? Have you, ma'am? Did you not have to sign it? You too, sir? There's a contract, an adopted parent. It's a long process to go through for a person to adopt a child. Anywhere in the world, by the way. It's not just in America. Even some of the most godless places on this planet. China, Russia, wherever you want to go. When it comes to adopting children, it's pretty much the same everywhere, and it has been down throughout human history. You have to draw up a contract with the law. The adopted parent, the adopting parent, has to sign the contract with the law. The contract is put in place and enforced by the law for the protection of the adopted child. And the stipulations within the adoption papers and contract hold the adopting parent liable, and responsible. And the adopting parent is under some mandatory requirements. One of the great clauses in the adoption contract for the is that your adopted child cannot be disinherited. Did you know that? That's an interesting fact, and I'll tell you why. Because in the book of Romans, chapter 8, when Paul was talking to the Romans in that day, he was talking about the spirit and the law of adoption. And the reason he was talking to them, because it was a big practice at that time for people to adopt, just like it really always has been anywhere. But he knew that in Rome, it was a very common practice for mom and dads to go to the courts there and actually adopt their own blood children. And the reason is, by adopting their blood children, their children had the protection of the law. Now, nothing they had could be taken away from their children because the law demands that it all be given to the adopted child. You cannot disinherit an adopted child. The adopted child had more legal rights than the blood child. This is a fact. And if you understand, we now step into a relationship with our Father in heaven. He adopted us. Okay? That's why we're called the chosen and the called out. It's like going into an adoption agency said, I choose you. I call you out. The Father is the one that went to the law and said, I want to adopt. And then there's a contract that the Father has to agree to. And you are protected by the law. That very same law that once pursued you and condemned you is now the very same law that protects you and serves you. Do you get what I'm saying? And therein lies why in the book of Romans chapter 8 at the very end of it, he says, and all things have worked together for good. You know, that law that once condemned is now the very same law that now protects. If you know the law, you know the gospel. And Jesus came to satisfy that law, and he did. And thank you, Jesus. But it was the law that is and was the heartbeat of the gospel. And until you understand the legal aspects of it, you're never going to get it. The book of Romans ain't nothing but a legal paper. The broken law, the completed law. The broken law, every word is every other wall. Same word in the book of Romans is like the law this, the law that, the law this, the law that. Well, it's two different laws. One that condemns and one that protects. It's the same law, but it has two different. This side of Jesus, you're in trouble. This other side of Jesus, you can just rest. But anyway, that's what I could be here all night long. Charlie and Linda both always tell me, shut up and sing. Now you tell me, how in the world could I write a song to say what I just said? There's not enough time in a song to get into the simplicity of the gospel. It is so simple, it confounds the wise. We're so busy missing it and don't understand, you know. To know the gospel is much better than to believe. I know salvation comes by trust and faith in Jesus. But Jesus spent 3.5 years all through the book of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John talking about one thing. To know. To know. To K-N-O-W. To know. It's to know something that brings peace to a life. Salvation comes through faith in him. But knowledge in this life of something is what brings you peace. And it starts and begins and ends with the law. And understand that we now are we're sons of the Father by law. And he's the one bound to keep that law, not you and I. We can't keep it, but it can keep us. And if we understood that, we'd understand why the true perspective of the gospel is a legalistic issue. But not from the you keeping the law. There's a positive side to legalism, and it's called it keeping you. I'm sure glad. See, there is a good side to everything, even legalism. But I wrote this song because I've been trying to figure out how in the world. I know what I know now. Death no longer scares me. You know, I'm real sure the Father don't. He hates fear. I know he does. And the reason I do is because he said, fear is not of me. It is of the evil one. And he said 365 times in the scriptures, fear not, I won't leave you. I never will leave you. Fear not, fear not, fear not. 365 times, one for every day of the year. Okay? I have a feeling, you know, if you say something once, that's one thing. You say it twice, that's another. Three times, they're probably trying to get you to understand something, right? But when he says it 365 times, I have a feeling he might be telling you what he's trying to do. He's trying to get fear out of your life. Because I'm here to testify, you cannot be in peace and fear. You're in peace or fear. And I contend that most of us are in fear and don't even know it. We're so used to being in it. And if you had more time, if you ever, you're interested, I'll drive all the way back from Arizona if you're in the deep want to know any more than I've got time to tell you tonight. Because I'm here to tell you right now, Jesus didn't die just to save you. He died to give you some peace in this life. But salvation ain't going to bring you no peace in this life. That's the first step to it, of course. You can't know the Father until you trust the Son. But it's peace and knowledge of the law. To know what is one thing, but to know why and how is another thing. I now understand. We, the Baptists, like to argue about eternal security. That's not even close to the proper perspective to debate the issue. It's not a debatable issue. If you understand the law, there's nothing to debate. Okay? He couldn't throw me out if he wanted to. It's illegal. Okay? He'd be breaking the law. And that's why he designed it that way, because he knows he can't break the law. He's holy. He's righteous. He's perfect. He is the law. Ah, if we only knew the gospel, we would be free of any fear. And you flip fear over, that is peace, abundant. But this song, every line's in the scripture. It's what he says about me, simply because of my trust in Jesus and how he views me. I know who I am and will always be. Now and forever, for in Christ I am free. I made peace with my God through the blood of Calvary. Reconciled completely, that's what the cross did for me. I'm a child of a promise that will forever stand. And by faith in my Savior, I am a righteous man. I'm an heir to a kingdom not built by human hands. I'm a son, not a slave, thanks to the Son that he gave. I know who I am. I know who I am. And all my Father sees is the precious blood of my Savior. And one more perfect Son in me. Ever forgiven, washed in the blood of this Lamb. Once a sinner, now a saint. Yes, I know who I am. And I am the crown in glory of the great I am. Amen. If you didn't listen real close to what I said, much less sang, you might want to reevaluate your salvational status. And I mean that, because I'll tell you what I know. If you know Jesus, the Holy Spirit is in you, okay? And when the truth is being spoke, it's going to stir him. And if it don't do something to you inside, and I'm not saying it necessarily makes you act like a goofball and start doing double back flips down the hallway and all that stuff. But I do believe that it should make you do double back flips down the middle of your heart, okay? And when things like that are said and or sang, and you just sit there and it don't move you, you really need to consider your salvation. Because I am I know for a fact, when things of heaven are spoke in the presence of a believer, the Holy Spirit ain't sitting there watching football, okay? He was sent to do some things to you, convict you. We always think that's a good news or bad thing, conviction. Why do we, sometimes you go to court and sometimes the verdict is innocent. I'm innocent. The Holy Spirit, everything he's going to do for you is good. And if you're sitting there right now thinking, boy, I wish he would shut up and sing, and or boy, I'm getting bored, you need to consider your salvation. Okay? And I mean that. But you know what? I ain't Jesus. I can't save your soul. If he can't wake you up, there ain't nothing I can do for you. You know, we drive ourselves nuts, Charlie, trying to do what only the Holy Spirit can do. You know, and the Father says, plain as a, it's right there in red, white, and blue. Their hearts get so hard sometimes, I can't even reach them. Well, then why do you labor trying to do something that even heaven can't do? All you can do is throw the words of truth out there, let them fall where they will. You know, and I hate to break the news to you, the majority are not going to heaven. That's not good news. And that's heartbreaking news. And if I could, I'd force you into heaven. I'd put you in a stinking headlock and jerk you in there, right? But you know what? He would too. But guess what? He can't. You know why? It's illegal. He can't violate your free will. But I do know one thing. We live in denial. A lot of people think, well, I'm going to heaven. I say, well, why? Well, I go to church. The largest church congregation in history is going to be held in hell. You be careful now. It's going to be one hot church. I'm not going to talk, because like I said, if he can't get you, I can't get you. Here's a song I wrote. You better get ready. In the testament of old 10,000 prophecies were made and came true. I've got 10,000 reasons to believe the prophecies of the new. Like in the book of James, chapter 5, verse 7 and 8, it's pretty clear. Second coming of the Lord is coming, and that time is drawing near. Better take a look around. It's time to read the writing on the wall. These are the final days we're living. This could be my Lord's final call. Better take a look around. I don't know. I forgot my words. Well, you got the message, right? He's coming. I'm getting ready, 'cause he's standing at the door. He's waiting and watching. That day I'm waiting for, in his name I shall glory. His victory is won, I'm getting ready. Ready or not, he will come. It's time to get ready. Ready or not, here he comes. Here he comes. Ouch. Thank you, folks. I don't know my own songs no more, huh? I'm getting old. You're not supposed to look at another man like that, okay? I'm just kidding, little buddy. I am getting old. I'll tell you what is wrong. I'm no excuses, but the fact is, what is today, Sunday? This last Monday, my intestines went haywire on me. I got shot in the stomach when I was a kid. And I was in Arizona, of course. That's where my wife and we're doing a little show out there in a theater. And it starts up in about 2 weeks, and we've been working really hard the last couple of weeks getting everything up and running. But every once in a while, I got like 5 bullet holes in my intestines. They had to take they gutted me like a trout way back when, and went to fix the bullet holes in my intestine. Pretty big deal back when I was 19, 20 years old. Picked up a hitchhiker and he shot me, right? But it took my intestines out and they fixed them all up. Well, as time's gone by, I've built up some lesions on my intestines. And there's a point to all this. It's not on my head, okay? But the intestines have lesions, and every once in a while, when I get sick or a little virus is coming around, it always settles in my intestines, and they swell up. And the intestines swell up on the inside, and they shut down. And I want you to go ahead and add 1 + 1, and you'll figure out why that is not good when your intestines don't work. And then you go about 5 or 6 days with not able to use your intestines. And all the food you've been eating is just sitting there just festering. The poison starts spreading throughout your system. It becomes physically impossible to lay down, sleep, do anything. It hurts. It cramps and stays in a cramped state for just as hard as it can tighten up. And you're getting sick with every minute. And you can't sleep. And it's getting worse because of that fact. You can't eat. You can't drink. You know, you're dying. And I went through that this last week, from Monday till Friday morning, after not sleeping much at all, obviously, and getting worse. And I had a commitment to do a golf tournament for the Chamber of Commerce out there Friday morning. And I don't think golf was the thing for me to be doing, right? I couldn't get even stand up, much less swing a golf club. But I told him I'd be there, so I went there. I played golf Friday morning from 8 o'clock till about 3 in the afternoon. I jumped in the car and started driving to get here as fast as I could. It took me, I slept 2 hours somewhere in Texas between 3 o'clock Friday afternoon and got here last night around 3, and with no sleep and all that other stuff going on. So I think the moral to my story is I'm really, really haggard, okay? I slept 4 hours last night after the thing we did, because after all that, I'd stayed to work last night, and I spent what little energy I had on that thing last night, and I'm tired, and my brain ain't working. It's just real cloudy. Somewhere along the way, this broke, though, and the relief is there now. I'm not hurting there, but boy, it wore me out, and I'm 55. I ain't 25. Bounce back I ain't got, okay? So I said all that to say this. I can't even remember my name right now, okay? And I am literally shaking hands with dead people. So that's why I seem dingier than normal. But of course, if you didn't know me, you wouldn't know that, would you? I tell you what I'm going to do. I'm going to do you one more song. I'm going to get out of y'all's hair if that's okay. And maybe I'll do 2 songs. Do we have any fans of my dad's music? Yeah? I'll go ahead and do that one song I was talking about. Charlie wants me to tell you the story. I can't believe it. He wants me to talk, but he does. The quicker, there ain't no such thing, Charlie. Good grief. Well, I can't help it. My dad wrote this song, a real quick version of what took place in his life. He actually wrote a book about it called Sing Me Back Home. It's a great book. One of the accounts in the book was, the title of the book came from a story, this song right here, that he wrote about his friend he was in San Quentin with. The old man was doing life. He was in the cell right next to my dad's cell. And my dad was just a kid on the wrong road of life, of course, headed probably to hell. But he did not sing at this time, of course. He was only 18 or 19 years old when they sent him to San Quentin for 1 to 15 years. And what got him in so much trouble all the time was he kept breaking out of everywhere they put him. 17 different times he broke out of somewhere. And that's why they sent him to prison, because he kept breaking out of places. And while he was in there, he made friends with that old man in the cell next to him. And they were talking one day, and Rabbit was his name, like the little bunny rabbit. But Rabbit mentioned to my dad that he thought he may have found a way to break out of San Quentin. Well, my dad wanted to go with Rabbit on this escape. And at the time, my dad had no thoughts to doing anything good in life yet. But Rabbit told my dad, he said, "Merle, I'm an old man doing life. I have nothing to lose, but you do." He said, "You need to straighten up and get out of here and do something with your life before it's too late." He said, and it's Rabbit that told my dad, he said, "Merle, you got a gift for music, and you need to do something with it before it's too late." And he said, "Don't go with me." He said, "Because if you do," he said, "you'll never be able to turn back." And Rabbit told him, "I am not coming back here without a fight." He said, "So unless you're willing to die, you really don't want to go with me." But he talked him out of going with him. And that was a hard thing for me to believe, that my dad finally listened to somebody, because he normally didn't listen to nobody. But he stayed behind, and Rabbit and two other men did break out of San Quentin prison. And it took the law about 2 weeks to catch up with them in San Jose, California. Found them in a hotel there, and in the process of trying to take them into custody, Rabbit and his two friends put up a fight, and the two men that were with Rabbit were killed, and Rabbit killed a policeman trying to get away. Well, they caught him, tried him, and found him guilty, and sentenced him to die on death row in San Quentin prison. When they brought him back to prison to execute him for his crime of killing that policeman, they were walking him to death row, and I guess he seen my dad. My dad was standing as close as he could get to him, just to sort of wave and say goodbye to him. And he asked the warden, he said, "Warden," his last request to the warden was, "Can I get my friend to sing me one more song?" And there was a song that his mama used to sing for him when he was a kid, and he wanted my dad to sing him that song. Well, the warden allowed it, and my dad sang for him one more song. They took Rabbit on down to death row, and eventually they executed him. And it was that series of events that sort of got my dad realizing that he was on the wrong road. Plus, Rabbit had said something about music being something to do for a living. My dad had never thought about that. And it was about that same time that John Cash came into the prison and did a show, and my dad realized, yeah, that's what I want to do right there. He made his mind up, quit messing around, get out of there and do something through music. It took him 3 years before they finally let him out. And in 1960, he came home to Bakersfield, California. An old convict, and my mom and me and my sister were living in an old boxcar, and that's where he came home, went to work in the local bands around Bakersfield, and for 3 years kicked around there. Finally, somebody in the town recognized what a great singer he was, and they cut a song on him, and long story made short, the rest is history. Every single song he cut from 1964 on was top 10 or better, 110 of them, more than anybody in music history, as big a most influential country artist probably of all time. But it was in 1966 he wrote this song. It was one of those great songs of my dad's. It was a number one record. And it was the song that always separated him from the pack, because his songs that he wrote were all songs about his life. And sometimes it had to do with a little drinking. You know, his yesteryears weren't perfect. Okay? But this song, he was... 66, he was 3 or 4 years into his career. He had had a couple number one records by then. He was really off and running. It had only been about 5 or 6 years since he was in San Quentin prison. Nobody knew him from Adam back then. Now he's a star. He realized that it all turned on the recommendation of that old man in prison. My dad wrote this great song about his friend Rabbit. It was a number one record, and true story. And if you knew the full story, Buy the book and read it. You'll love it. The warden led a prisoner down the hallway to his doom. And I stood up to say goodbye like all the rest. I heard him tell the warden just before he reached my cell, let my guitar playing friend do my request. Let him sing me back home with a song I used to hear, and make my old memories come alive, and take me away and turn back the years, and sing me back home before I die. I recall that Sunday morning, a choir from off the streets came in to sing a few old gospel songs. Heard him tell the singers, there's a song my mama sang, would you sing it once before you move along? Won't you sing me back home with a song I used to hear, and make my old memories come alive, and take me away and turn back the years, and sing me back home before I die. Won't you sing me back home before I die. Thank you, folks. Oh, bless you guys. It's hot. I'm going to do you one more song, and I'm out of y'all's hair, all right? We do have some, I have some CDs back there if you want them. Linda will be back there handling it if you want. I won't get into it like I used to. There's three CDs. Two of them are tributes that I've cut to my dad. I'm doing a little tribute show to my dad in Arizona. I was up in Branson for a while, but I hated the politics of the music business up there, so I went to Arizona where there ain't no other musicians there, okay? And musicians are a bunch of knuckleheads mostly. Every once in a while, there's pretty good ones. But I'm in Arizona doing a little tribute to my dad's music. I want to keep his music alive because real country music's all but dead, and I want to see if I can't revive it a little bit. And so I'm paying a tribute to him out there. But, of course, while I'm out there, I never shut up about the Father either. Trust me. And, you know, ministry's everywhere you go. It don't have to only be in the church. Good grief. In fact, although the greatest ministry, I believe, is in it, in the church. But anyway, I got two CDs, tributes to my dad's music. I got one CD of my original stuff. I actually remember the lyrics on the CDs, okay? They're all songs that I've written about my father, and he is my passion. And given a choice to sit and talk about my dad's music or my father's word, it's not even a contest. I could probably talk forever about the gospel and have no problems doing it. I love it. It is my life. And it is sure good news to know that the law that once pursued me is now the law that protects me. And anyway, but here's a little song I wrote. Thank you, guys. You've been good. When I was young, just a kid, I tried to do everything just like my daddy did.
right down to the way he sang a tune. Proud just to be my father's son. In my eyes, he was the best at everything he'd done. As far as I was concerned, he hung the moon. Oh, how it would thrill me so. Deep down in my heart, don't you know? Every time someone would say, boy, you've got your father's ways. When it comes to you, son, it's plain to see. The apple didn't fall too far from his tree. Things have changed since way back then. As a full-grown man, I've been born again. These days I'm singing a different tune. Cause I want to walk like Jesus walked. I want to talk like Jesus talked. After all, our Father hung that moon. Oh, how it would thrill me so. Deep down in my heart, don't you know? If someday someone could say, boy, you've got your Father's ways. When it comes to you, son, it's plain to see. The apple didn't fall too far from his tree. God gave his only son unto me. And he died on that cross to set me free. Well, I pray I never fall too far from that tree. Oh, how it would thrill me so. Deep down in my heart, don't you know? Every time someone would say, boy, you've got your father's ways. When it comes to you, son, it's plain to see. The apple didn't fall too far from his tree. When I was young, just a kid, I tried to do everything just like my daddy did. But these days I'm trying to fill some different shoes. Thank you, folks. Thank you, folks.